Hello and welcome to week two of contemporary art. Today, this lecture is going to talk specifically about post-war art in America. So that immediate post-war period that I was talking about with you about the sort of 1945 and after, how things had changed across the globe because of World War II. Now we're going to get into the nitty-gritty of what's going on in America in post-war art. And I've got a couple of basic comments to make about the aftermath of World War II. Excuse me. In the 1940s, late 1940s, Henry Luce, who was the publisher of Time, dubbed the 20th century the American century. He made this argument that because America had been victorious in World War II, because there was this huge kind of economic boom going on in America as a result of the war, because American enterprise and industry were thriving, because America had become basically in charge of rebuilding under the Marshall Plan, both parts of Germany and Europe and Japan, America had become dominant. And he made this argument that the 20th century is going to be the century for America. And this really has held true, that America ascended to a superpower position really in the aftermath of World War II, economically and politically. And although, of course, that's been shifting in recent years as we get globalization and all of that, one of the effects of the American century and this global predominance of America was that the art world really shifted its focus and its epicenter from, traditionally, Paris had been the real epicenter for cutting edge thinking about art and styles of art. Now that real cutting edge is moving to New York. One of the reasons for this is because there are a number of European artists who had fled the war, had fled Hitler, had fled the Nazis, who ended up in New York and in America. So a whole generation of important cutting edge artists from Europe had ended up in the States. And so that's one of the reasons. We also have New York as the center, the economic center of the world. And there is also the emergence of this very exciting post-war painting phenomenon, a movement in art called abstract expressionism that was grounded both in the European theory that was coming across the Atlantic and the influence of this older generation of avant-garde artists, and also in this real striving to come up with a very American style of painting. And in fact, one of the canonical histories of how New York or abstract expressionism emerged and then became this globally dominant style for a while, very influential across the world, is actually, the book is actually titled How New York Stole the Idea of Modern Art. This is was written about 15 years ago. It's a standard work on the history of the post-war period. So just to give you a sense of how the feeling was at the time, that this sort of, all of a sudden, these upstart Americans come out of nowhere and there's this whole new focus of and center for the art world. So what we'll look at today is this manifestation in America of post-war art, the umbrella term for this group of painters, and excuse me, it's mostly painters really, who become very prominent in the post-war period. They're called the abstract expressionists, and they have several different names that were coined over time. I just want to point out, because they're all sort of interchangeable, they're sometimes called the New York School. They weren't a literal school, and as you'll see, they have somewhat distinct styles individually. It's more that they're united by a kind of philosophy about art and expression. You'll also see abstract expressionism abbreviated as ABEX. And they're sometimes called the American School or action painting. We are going to look really at two main subgroups of abstract expressionism: the gestural abstraction of painters like Jackson Pollock and Willem de Kooning, and the color field painting of Barnett Newman and Mark Rothko. So we're going to examine four painters. There are many more painters who are actually prominent in this school, so-called school. But we're just going to look at some representative people, because these guys, and they are actually all guys here, these guys are really at the forefront, and they are the most widely publicized and very influential of these abstract expressionist figures. And what they are thinking about and talking about will be again, the kind of stuff that percolates through contemporary art. Another thing that we'll look at is just considering the kind of world of the 1950s in America. And you can get a little flavor of this too if you watch Mad Men, which is more about 60s advertising on Madison Avenue, but it's the same general kind of culture that these guys are coming out of that has a very, very pronounced set of gendered expectations. The differences between what was possible for and expected of men and women in the post-war period. Part of this has to do with how conventional gender roles had really been upset by World War II. As men went off to fight, women stepped into factories, women played professional baseball. They did all this kinds of stuff that was normally not considered to be part of the realm of women and did it well. And so it was very threatening when all these guys come back from the war. One of the things that happens is women are sort of told point blank, you know, well, I know you've been working in this factory, but now there's a guy home, so he needs a job and you need to go back to the kitchen. And that kind of gender role expectation stuff that's general in the culture is something that also manifests itself in the art of the abstract expressionists. In fact, Pollock and de Kooning are both married in the 50s to abstract expressionist painters who, as you'll see when we're talking about them and looking at photographs of them, tended to end up being in the background. Not because they necessarily wanted to, but because, you know, when a newspaper photographer came by to photograph the painter, the painter's wife was not considered to be a painter. Anyway, we'll get into that a little bit more here in a minute. There's a photograph, a very famous photograph, of this group of abstract expressionist painters that, as you can see, it's called, and sorry that slide's cut off a little bit, the Irascibles is the nickname for this photograph. An irascible person is someone who's, you know, irritable and angry. So you've got this group of really angry young men, right? They're, as you can see, all youngish white males, except for one woman there in the background. Jackson Pollock is in the second row from the back, sitting there kind of looking over his shoulder at us, FYI. So the Irascibles, and yes, mostly the Irascibles are young white male painters, and that was pretty much the definition of a painter in this point in time. There's another woman who we'll look at later who was a painter in the 1950s as well. Her name was Miriam Shapiro. She and her husband got their MFAs at the same time, moved to New York City in this period, the late 1940s. Although they both had MFAs, Shapiro says she could not find a job except as working as a secretary, while her husband was hired in a tenure-track position to teach painting in college. And it wasn't that they had different credentials. They had the same MFA from the same university. It was that there was simply an accepted hierarchy. That, you know, men were to be professionals and women were to stay at home. And you can kind of get this playing out a little bit in this photo of the Irascibles. There's another painter we'll look at later, a guy named Norman Lewis, who was also an abstract expressionist style painter in the 1950s. He was African American, and although he was friends with this entire group of people, as were many of the women who, sort of took a back seat, when it came to doing publicity photos or things like that, it wasn't, I mean, he just was not considered part of the group. So it's very kind of typical of the 1950s, I would say. So what I want to do now is look at the paintings of a couple of these painters and make some comments about how abstract expressionism explodes onto the scene. Oops. Okay, the first painting I want to look at here is this painting by Jackson Pollock. It's from the 1940s, so it's a little bit earlier than the time I really want to consider. But just to give you a sense of the direction that Pollock is going, Jackson Pollock actually started training with a realist, an American realist painter named Thomas Hart Benton back in the 30s. By the 40s, he's moving in a more abstract direction, as you can see here in this painting called Male and Female, which is referencing archetypes, right? Male and female as gender opposites, the moon and the sun, math and logic versus emotion, all of these kinds of binary oppositions of what's considered to be archetypally male and archetypally female. He was very interested in psychology and analysis. He was very interested in Freud and Carl Jung. And in this respect, he's really taking a cue from the kinds of interests that the surrealist painters had had earlier in the 20th century. And he was influenced by these ideas. He also happened to be going through analysis himself at this point in time. Freudian analysis is a very intense and long process where you meet with an analyst 3 times a week and go through discussing your childhood and the archetypal moments of your childhood, where you go through your anal retentive stage as your potty training, or you go through this edible, if you're a boy, an edible stage where you want to marry your mother and get rid of your father. A lot of Freudian theory has been somewhat questioned over time, but I mean, this was very predominant in the 1940s. So Pollock is glomming onto some trends that we've already seen in European art. I'll just remind you here of Joan Miró's Carnival of Harlequin. This is something we looked at last time briefly, just as an example of automatic drawing and surrealist attempts at capturing the subconscious in paint. Here's another 40s painting by Jackson Pollock. This one is called Moon Woman Cuts the Circle, and it's here the same kind of thing where you're getting some figurative elements, a push towards some kind of abstraction. I think you can probably see the influence of Salvador Dali as well as Joan Miró in a painting like this. The interesting thing that Pollock does here is, that is kind of injecting an American American flavor into this painting, the colors of the painting and the subject of the painting are both drawn from North American, Native American or Indian mythology. Okay. The moon woman is also tied to this idea of, you know, women being associated with the moon and the night and emotion, and men being associated with the sun and logic and day and light. This is, again, Pollock kind of trying to explore these universal themes, these themes about the subconscious, the sort of archetypal getting at deeper truths and deeper meanings in his painting. Where Pollock really makes the breakthrough that changes his painting is in the later 1940s. So here I'm showing you his painting called Full Fathom 5. This is from 1947. It is currently at the Museum of Modern Art in New York City. So if you're ever there, you can go look it up. This is a pretty large painting. It's about 51 inches tall by 30 inches wide, so it's a fairly big canvas. It is a canvas that includes a lot of non-traditional items. So it's a canvas that has not only oil paint on it, but also nails, tacks, buttons, keys, coins, cigarettes, matches, and other objects that are embedded into the surface and are meant to make the texture of the overall painting. It's almost like Pollock was trying to do some sort of occult practice here, where he's embedding stuff into the painting you don't necessarily see on the surface. It helps to give the painting texture. It also helps to encode some sort of hidden meanings into the painting. Okay. Here's just a close-up. You can see a dime embedded into the paint of Full Fathom 5 here, and then you can see how there's all this very thickly impastoed paint that's being that's being laid down on the canvas. This is the first of what becomes Pollock's signature style, what are sometimes called drip paintings or action paintings, and he will take this idea of a fully abstract canvas on which the recording of his movements as a painter and his sort of internal expression coming out and being recorded on the canvas. This is the first of these paintings, and this is what he will become most known for. And here, just a couple of years later, as Pollock has gone on working in this technique, he produces more of these paintings, very large scale, even larger than all, or than, excuse me, full fathom five. So here is one of his paintings from 1950. This is really his breakthrough year, well, in his breakthrough years, where he's captured the art world's imagination with these really gigantic, enormous paintings. If you stand and look at one, it covers, usually in museums, it will cover an entire wall of a gallery, and if you stand within a couple feet of it, it fills up your entire vision. This is one of his more famous paintings, and from 1950, Lavender Mist. Here, Pollock has abandoned any kind of easel painting, which he had started with earlier on in his career, and he's started laying the canvases on the floor and using a whole host of unusual or atypical materials for making paintings that are enormous like this. So first of all, he doesn't use stretched canvas anymore. He uses an industrial sort of what's called duck cloth. It's the kind of stuff you use to make sails for sailboats with. So he's using an industrial material and pouring enamel paint, house paint, the kind of auto body paint that Ford used, stuff that you could get in gallon sizes, stuff that you could get cheaper, stuff that was very liquid, as well as traditional oil paints. He also stopped using a paintbrush. He would, instead of using a regular paintbrush, he would take the can of paint, pour directly from the can of paint. Sometimes he would puncture a hole in the can and then let it drip that way. He would take a turkey baster and squirt paint onto the canvas. He would take the butt end of an old brush and dip that into a can of paint and then fling it onto the canvas. The idea being that he would walk around on this enormous canvas, dripping and splashing paint, as the mood struck him, as a sort of choreographed dance or a performance. And he compared this in some ways to the kind of activity that you would see shamans doing in Native American sand painting rituals. So he had grown up in Cody, Wyoming, and he really played up the idea that he was this Western American cowboy kind of figure. And he actually said, you know, one of the reasons that I paint such big canvases is because I'm an American. I grew up in the West. I just feel more at home in a large space. So really getting away from traditional oil paintings, the kind of stuff even that the Surrealists had done, where you would have a relatively small stretched canvas that you would be putting on an easel and then dabbing at daintily with traditional oil paints. This was meant to be a much more free and expressive and macho sort of painting style. Here I'm just showing you a couple of stills from a very famous documentary done in October of 1950 when Pollock was working on another one of these very large canvases. So you can see there he is at work on a painting that would become known as Autumn Rhythm. There are this week also in Blackboard some clips from this Hans Nemeth documentary, very famous documentary. I just want you to watch because it has a couple of quotes from Pollock and it shows him actually moving around the canvas and painting. And again, this is, you know, just to get a sense of how Pollock was working. Pouring, dripping, splashing, walking around the canvas. He made a big deal out of this idea that he needed a big space to work in. He needed a space that he could be completely at ease in. And he says, he puts his paintings on the floor to paint because on the floor, I am more at ease. I feel nearer, more a part of the painting, since this way I can walk around in it, work from the four sides, and be literally in the painting. This here is the painting that he created during the filming of that documentary. It's called Autumn Rhythm. This one's at the Metropolitan Museum of Art. And I have a shot here in a minute of what it looks like in person. It's 207 inches across, and I forget how many inches tall, but you can see that it doesn't translate so well to the screen here. It's a really gigantic painting that is that is meant to fill your entire range of vision. And again, part of this comes from the ideas of the surrealists and automatic drawing and letting your subconscious kind of bleed through and not have any sort of conscious controls over it. Partly, he said, it came from the idea of Native American sand painters in the West. So there's this very shamanistic performance element to doing a painting like this, as well as this idea that what he's trying to do is capture an experience or to make something that is a painting just about itself. It's not a painting that's about literal psychological symbolism. It's not a painting that's telling you a story. It is a kind of record of his experience of creating the painting. Now, that's not to say that he did this with complete lack of control, and he often was very insistent in interviews talking about how he was doing this spontaneously, but that doesn't mean he was doing it without any idea of where he was going or without any choices being made. He was very insistent that this was something that was not necessarily planned. It was meant to be, you know, a capturing experience thing, but it wasn't meant to be chaotic. It wasn't meant to be completely random either. These paintings were, when they appeared in public in galleries like Peggy Guggenheim's gallery, Art of the Century, they made a huge splash. And he also, Pollock himself, had this kind of dominating personality. He was very macho, you know, and he was a hard drinker, and he liked to be kind of gruff, and he liked to cultivate this tough guy, nonverbal, sort of almost Brando-esque personality. In fact, there's a famous story about him getting really, really drunk at Peggy Guggenheim's house one night and urinating in her fireplace instead of going into the bathroom to urinate. The kind of thing that, you know, shocked people and seemed to be kind of outside the pale, really living up to this idea of the artist who is outside of any normal bourgeois conventions. One abstract expressionist painter, actually his wife, who got to know him during this time, said that when she first saw his paintings, they seemed like something new. She said they seemed like monumental drawings, or maybe painting with the immediacy of drawing, or some new category of art. Now there is the picture of Autumn Rhythm installed on the wall in the gallery, so you can see how if you're standing anywhere near it, it would really take up your whole line of vision, and it becomes a kind of experience in and of itself. Oftentimes I find that people are resistant to Jackson Pollock. They say things like, and this is a very common thing that a reaction people have, is, well, you know, my kid could do that. And I have to say, I understand where this comes from, because obviously you've got this kind of painting that seems to take no technique at all, but I would just say, one thing you ought to do is go actually see a Pollock in person. This fall, the SOCA is sponsoring, as it always does every semester, a trip to a museum. This fall, it'll be the Art Institute of Chicago, and there is a Pollock painting in the Art Institute. There aren't many up right now because they're going through renovations, but I highly recommend that you go and see a Pollock in person and stand in front of it. Stand close enough to it that you can really kind of start to look at the surface texture. These are very tactile paintings. They're very three-dimensional because there are many, many layers of paint, and sometimes, as in the case of Full Fathom 5, other objects embedded in these paintings. And they are visually quite powerful. I used to be a skeptic myself, but the more that I've seen of these Pollock paintings in person, I have to tell you, they do have some kind of visual presence. And I find, too, that, you know, people often try to recreate Jackson Pollock paintings, and often they just don't come off as successfully. They're never big the way that his paintings are. They're never as densely layered and complicated. It doesn't have to be your favorite kind of art, but before you throw the baby out with the bathwater, keep in mind what it was he was trying to do in these paintings and this kind of overall experiential moment you're supposed to have in front of a painting like this before you just dismiss it as something that just anybody can do. Just give it a chance. Oh, Oh, here, by the way, a couple of close-ups of sections of Autumn Rhythm, so you can see that there's all kinds of interesting stuff getting stuck onto the canvas, layers of paint, that they're very, very textural. There's a lot going on. One of your assignments this week is also to read an interview with a curator at the MoMA who deals with these paintings and has to conserve them, and talking about what he's learned about Jackson Pollock's technique. Some interesting insights there, and thinking about whether or not this is completely random, whether or not, and sort of what the abstract expressionists were doing and the materials they were using, things like that. Here's another good quote, by the way, from Pollock. He says, "I'm very representational some of the time and a little all of the time, but when you're working out of your unconscious, figures are bound to emerge. Painting is a state of being. Painting is self-discovery. Every good artist paints what he is." So in other words, these are records of him as a psyche, him as a human being, him as a person having an experience of painting. And he also stressed that although he did not premeditate his paintings, they were not random or chaotic or accidental. As he says, "I can control the flow of paint. There is no accident." And here is just a side view of one of Pollock's paintings. There is a security guard standing next to the painting. I bring this in just to show you how deep and textural these paintings are. So they're not flat canvas surfaces. They almost become like little sculptures when you look at them. A couple more comments to make about Jackson Pollock. Here is a 1949 really famous two-page spread from Life magazine. Jackson Pollock, is he the greatest living painter in the United States? And there is Pollock standing and looking sort of macho and mute and wearing jeans. This does not look radical to us, I know, but in the 1950s, wearing jeans was a deliberate statement aligning yourself with the kind of rough and tumble element of society. Somebody who was working class, somebody who was tough. Okay, it's a little bit like, I don't know what the fashion equivalent would be today, but it was, jeans were a kind of cutting edge, rough and tumble, a little bit dangerous kind of thing to wear. All right, believe it or not, I know. So there he is in his jeans, in his work jacket, looking a little bit tough, standing in front of a mural he had painted for Peggy Guggenheim. And then this Life magazine article goes on to talk about, you know, the New York art world really loves this guy, and here's the kind of stuff he paints. So in the 1940s and 50s, generally, I mean, a guy like Jackson Pollock was pretty famous. You know, Life magazine was sort of the upscale version of People magazine, so he's pretty famous to be featured in the pages here. But there was a little bit of ambivalence. Time magazine also featured Jackson Pollock, and they called him Jack the Dripper, you know, as a kind of jokey nickname based upon this idea of gestural painting. So anyway, so he becomes quite famous. He's quite appealing to the ethos of the time. Here on the left is a publicity photo of Jackson Pollock. You would think that he was out on a ranch in Cody, Wyoming, driving his old truck, riding around in a pickup and doing hard farm labor. Actually, this was taken at his house on Long Island at a time when he was moving, or when he was living on Long Island and going into the city on the subway three times a week to have psychoanalysis done. On the right there is just a photo, publicity photo of Marlon Brando, who's kind of the quintessential 1950s movie icon, very kind of, he was the screen idol of the day, very, very handsome and well-built and featured in many roles where he was very masculine and kind of macho and even violent. And so you can see where there's a little bit of this broody, non-verbal, rough and tumble, shirt sleeves and work boots kind of guy that Jackson Pollock is cultivating that same kind of image. Pollock was actually a heavy drinker, and he died at the age of, 45, I think, in the 1950s in a car crash. He had been drinking, and he wrapped his car around a tree. And that only seems to have ramped up the mythology of Jackson Pollock, as a matter of fact. You know, other screen idols of the 50s did the same kind of thing. James Dean, Montgomery Clift. There was this whole generation of tragically doomed, live fast, die young, leave a good-looking corpse kind of men. And so that really fed into something that people in the 50s seemed to really need. One other thing I wanted to mention about Pollock and the abstract expressionists is that this was, as was 1950s culture, a very kind of male enclave, a very male world. I'm just going to read you a couple of quotes from women who were artists who were either married to other artists who were in this New York scene, drinking at the Cedar Tavern, or were single women who were trying to be part of the art scene at this time. So here, let's see.